Hello all, I'm Sushmita Sarkar from RV College of Engineering. I welcome you all for the course Power System Analysis 2, Module 1, Lecture 9. So I hope, my dear friends, that you remember what we have learned in our last lecture. We have learned about the algorithm of Gauss-Seidel method and where we have learned how to find out the voltages at all the buses. So once we know the voltages at all the buses, how to calculate the line flows, line losses, and slack bus power, which we'll learn in today's lecture. Fine, so let us start with our today's lecture. So if I have to calculate the line flows and line losses, first I should know what is the current equation. Fine, so current equation is Ip is equal to sigma q is equal to 1 to n, ypq vq, where P is equal to 1 to n number of buses. Basically, you're finding out current at all the particular buses, respective buses, okay? So now how do we write the complex power? All of you know the complex power can be represented as VI conjugate. So exactly, I'm going to use the same formula. SP is equal to VP IP conjugate. So VP IP value are going to substitute from there. And then you take the conjugate of it. So when you write the conjugate, you can see over here, you are getting YPQ conjugate as well as VQ conjugate. So now let us see, we have a term VP in this equation as well as VQ. So the VP can be represented in the form of magnitude and its angle. Fine, so VP can be of magnitude of VP at an angle of delta P. Similarly, VQ will be at a magnitude of VQ at an angle of delta Q. YPQ will be equal to GPQ plus JBPQ. So this is the way how we represented in rectangular form. So let us see how the equation changes with that. Fine, this is, and my delta P, VP and delta P, that is Z at an angle of theta, can be written as Z is equal to, that is Z at an angle of theta can be written as Z cos of theta plus J sine of theta. I hope all of you remember this, the same format I'm representing my voltage at the Pth bus also. Fine, so similarly, if I'm taking the delta PQ, which will be represented as delta P minus of delta Q, and YPQ, I told you in terms of GPQ plus JBPQ. There should be a J term which is missing over here. So let us write that over there so that you students don't do that mistake. It will be a fine. So this is will be a G plus of JBPQ, okay? So now when we write this equation, so my equation look like as VP VQ cos of delta PQ plus J sine of delta PQ into GPQ minus JBPQ, okay? Why did you got this minus sign? Because you have the conjugate, fine? So you have the YPQ conjugate in your equation. That's how you get the minus sign over here. What is my delta PQ? It is represented over here because I told you that VP is equal to, because you are writing the VP is equal to magnitude of VP at an angle of delta P. Similarly, you will be writing as VQ is equal to magnitude of VQ. Okay, so we'll be writing as magnitude of VQ at an angle of delta Q. Fine, so when you write like this, so you will have a term both in this particular format. So you should remember that VQ in your previous equation was a conjugate. Fine, so VQ and YPQ was a conjugate. That's how you get the minus sign in case of a delta Q. And here you get minus sign or the imaginary part, fine? So that is the reason we get the minus sign in the respective places. So now in this complex power equation, you will be separating the real part and the imaginary part to get the PP and QP. So how the PP looks, all of you know that the real part will be GPQ cos of delta P, because this part remains same. There's no changes in this. So when I multiply these two, my real part will give me GPQ cos of delta PQ, and this minus and J square gives you minus one. So it'll become plus, and you get it as BPQ sine delta BPQ. I hope it is clear. Similarly, when we'll be writing an equation for QP, QP equation is going to be GPQ sine of delta PQ minus BPQ cos of delta BQ. Okay, so this is your equation for PP and QP. So this is basically, I'm representing the PP and QP equation in rectangular form when I'm taking these values in rectangular form. Fine, so now if you wanted to do it in a polar form, so polar form, my YPQ will be magnitude of YPQ at an angle of theta PQ. So when you substitute, so you can see that your VP is in at an angle position VP of delta P. So basically there you have taken your YPQ in rectangular form. Here you are taking YPQ in polar form. How does my equation changes? So I have taken, why I'm getting minus theta PQ and minus delta Q. As per your equation, SP is VP IP conjugate. So it is VP IP conjugate. So IP conjugate, this is your YPQ conjugate and VQ conjugate. This conjugate affects your angles, fine, in case of a polar form. So that is how we are getting the, fine. So that is how we are getting the minus theta PQ and minus delta Q. So the real part gives the PP, real part PP when you separate it. So you can check it out. What do you get it as? I will take the VP, let it be outside, and I'm taking what? YPQ and VQ I'm writing over here, and cos of minus theta PQ, this is minus, plus delta P minus delta Q. So you are getting the same equation. So I can rewrite this. I can just take the minus sign. I hope it's clear, guys. The cos part, because when you put anything z at an angle of theta, fine, so you get it as cos of theta plus j sine theta. Fine, so cos theta will give you the real part and j sine theta will give you the reactive part. So cos of theta, when I take it as, so what are the angles I have? I have minus theta PQ, so I have written minus. I have plus delta P, this is your plus delta P, so you have plus delta P. And this is your minus, because you know in polar form, when you are adding it up, addition, angles will get added up. So this is your minus of delta P, so you minus delta Q, so you get minus of delta Q. So I want to take this minus sign out. So I'm taking the minus sign out. This will become plus, this will become minus, and this will become plus. So cos of minus theta is basically a cos theta. So cos of minus theta is cos theta, which I told you just now. So you will be getting the equation in this particular form. So this is a real power equation in polar form. Okay. Similarly, the reactive power equation in polar form, the J sine term will come over here. So here you remember the sine minus theta will become equal to what will become minus sine theta. So your equation in reactive part, you will be getting this negative sign because it is a minus sine theta. Fine. I hope till here it is clear for everyone. How do I write PP and QP equation in terms of rectangular and polar form? Fine. So now how to calculate the line flows? So let us understand how do we calculate the line flows. So now I have taken a simple network to make you understand how to calculate these values. So now you can see there is a bus P and Q whose series line impedance is YPQ, whose half line charging admittances, I have written it as YPQ zero. Both the sides, it will be same YPQ zero. These are your half line charging admittances. Fine, now the current which is coming from the Pth bus, it gets, so I am writing a current which is coming from Pth bus, that is my, the for a particular line PQ. So I'm writing as YPQ. Fine, the flow of the current is from Pth bus to the Qth bus. Now this current gets divided into two parts. I have taken it as YPQ1 and YPQ0. Fine, YPQ1 and YPQ0. Similarly, the current which is coming from the Q bus to Pth bus, it is YQP. So this also will divide it into two parts, YQP1 and YQP0. Okay, and so my power flow from bus P to Q is SPQ, and power flow from bus Q to P is my SQP. Fine. If there are no difference between the from SPQ and SQP, then you have no losses. The difference between these two only will give you the losses, basically. Fine. So now the power fed into the line from bus P is, so I'm going to calculate this SPQ. What is this SPQ? So SPQ is nothing but PPQ plus of JQP, which also can be written as VP into IPQ conjugate. So now this IPQ is divided into IPQ1 and IPQ0. Okay, so basically you have IPQ1 and IPQ0, this IPQ. So I have to write the expression taking both the voltages drops, okay? So now first one I'm getting at, so this VP remains, as it is VP over here. So basically I'm concentrating on IP conjugate. So the first term, which is I'm getting it as VP into IPQ1 plus VP into IPQ0. So you can see the VP is over here. So this is your IPQ1, Okay, so this gives you your IPQ1. What does it says? That is VP conjugate minus VQ conjugate multiplied by YPQ conjugate. Similarly, what is this particular IPQ0? IPQ0 is nothing but VP multiplied by YPQ0. Okay, so like this, you are going to write your equation for SPQ, the power flow from Pth bus to the Qth bus. Okay, so basically this is the power which is from Pth bus to down. So it has to be actually VP. This also has to be VP conjugate. Okay, this also has to be VP. This is a voltage drop across. This will be your this particular bus voltage. So VP is conjugate by YPQ conjugate 0. Fine. Similarly, the power fed into the line from bus Q is fine. So you are writing the same format. You are writing the equation from the other part. Fine. So VQ, VP conjugate, YPQ not. Okay. So that is about your line flows. Now line losses. So how do I calculate? If I know the power flow from Pth bus to the Qth bus and Qth bus to the Pth bus, how do I calculate the power losses? So the power loss in the Pth to Qth line is the sum of the power flows determined from the equation SPQ and SQP. That is, power loss will be the addition of these two powers for all PQ buses. Fine. So now the total transmission losses can be computed by summing all the line flows. Like this, if we calculate all the line flows, add up all those, will give you the total transmission losses. Fine. If there are any mutual coupling between the transmissions line, then we find the current between those lines and then compute the line flows. Okay, because you know with a mutual coupling the values differ, so you need to calculate in such cases the line current first and then calculate the line flows. The slack bus power can also be found by summing up the flows on the lines which are terminating at that particular bus. Okay, all the lines which are terminating at slack bus, add up all those line flows, will give you slack bus power. Fine. Now, after understanding how to calculate the line flows and line losses, let us understand what are the operating constraints of the system. So the first operating constraint is the voltage magnitude must satisfy the inequality constraint, which means the voltage at every bus has certain limit. Okay, so it should not go beyond that limit. So basically you will have a minimum margin and the maximum margin. So that is your VP minimum less than equal to VP less than equal to VP max. Fine. That is your first operating constraint. Second operating constraint talks about the active power generation. So your active power generation also has a limit and it should not go beyond that limit. So it is your generation at Pth bus minimum limit and this is your maximum limit. So basically your generation at that particular bus should maintain this particular limit. And third limit is about the reactive power. Fine. So which is, we say also limitations of generator field excitations constrain the reactive power generation. So which is on QGP minimum less than equal to QGP less than equal to QGP max. So if this limit on QP also, so that QP minimum less than equal to QP is equal to, so this sets limit on QP at this particular reactive power generation also set the limit at particular bus. The reactive power at that particular bus should not cross this particular minimum and maximum limits. Fine. So what is next? Considerations of stability impose constraints on the maximum permissible power angles between two buses P and Q connected via transmission line. So basically we are talking about delta P minus of delta Q. That also should be less than or equal to the maximum limit. Fine. So now since the complex power has to be conserved at all buses, so your generation should meet the demand plus the losses, which is very normal understanding that we should know that I have to generate which is able to supply the demand as well as able to compensate the losses. Fine. Similarly, the reactive power also same way we have to define. So where PL and QL are the total system real and reactive power losses respectively. Now, what are these violations of operating limits? What happens? We are talking about these are certain constraints in voltages, reactive power, real power, the deltas. Now, what happens when, how does these limits depends on, or what happens when these violates the limit? So the limit, all the generations depends on the type of generation. So whether it is a thermal power plant, it is a hydropower plant, or it is any other power plant, solar power plant, whatever it is. So these power plants and on the rating of the generator. So there's no question of solar power plant in that case. So we can take as a wind power plant. Fine. So it all depends on that. What is the limit of the PGP based on the power stations you have? Fine. So we cannot supply active power more than the sum of the maximum power generation of all the generators in the system without a decrease in frequency. So it is very simple to understand that your generation cannot supply more than your generation. And if you have to do so, the frequency, you have to undergo a particular frequency. That means if you decrease the frequency, you may be able to do that. Fine. At a PV bus, if the Q limit is violated, then it means that the voltage can no longer be held at the specified value. So you will be understanding this particular concept also. We'll be mentioning in our next lectures that if the PQ buses are coming into picture, in that case, if the Q limits of that particular bus gets violated, then that particular bus will be considered as load bus. No more the specified voltage can be considered as your further calculations. So in that case, you need to calculate as you calculate for simple PQ buses. Fine. That is in case if the Q limits gets violated at PV bus. Similarly, at a PQ bus, violation of voltage limits means that the specified Q can no longer be met within the voltage limit. So we have told about the voltage limit in the previous slide. So where you have seen at PQ buses, the main thing, you are finding out the voltages and angle at all the buses. So these values should be within the specified limit. Fine. Limits are violated due to the limitations of the components used and due to operating state. So if your limits are getting violated, these are the two reasons. The first reason is the components which we are using it, and second is the operating condition. Fine. Okay, so after understanding the constraints on the system and how it violates, what is the consequences of that, after understanding that particular concept, now let us come to an approximate load flow solution. What is an approximate load flow solution? Whenever we use the term approximate, it is understood that we are going to make few assumptions. Fine. Based on the few assumptions, we are going to make our equations simpler. And how these equations will make an iterative procedure into a non-iterative solutions, we'll see into that. So first we'll see what are these assumptions, fine? So assumption number one, we are going to consider the line resistance, which are very, very small, fine? So we usually neglect that. So when you neglect the line resistance, what will happen? The losses will be equal to zero. So you basically are taking the PL, the active power losses are going to be zero. So which means the theta PQ is going to be, we are talking about 90 degree. Fine. So in my real power equations and reactive power equations, I'm going to put a theta PQ is equal to 90 degree. Now delta, the difference between this is going to be delta P minus delta Q is actually going to be very small value. So sine of that value will be almost equal to the same value. So when you take sine of delta P minus of delta Q, which all gives you, this is your sine delta P minus of delta PQ is almost equal to delta P minus of delta Q because the term is very, very small. So this is justified from consideration of stability. Now, all the buses, we are doing the third assumption as all the buses other than the slack buses, we are considered as PV bus. Fine. So voltage, which means the voltage magnitude at all the buses are known to us. Okay. So this is the third assumption. First assumptions, what we are doing it, we are neglecting the resistance values, which says the active power losses are zero and theta PQ becomes 90 degree. Second thing, we are taking delta P minus delta Q is very small. Hence, the size sine of delta PQ minus delta P minus delta Q is going to be almost equal to delta P minus of delta Q. Third one, we are considering in a system, one bus will be a slack bus, rest all the buses are going to be PV bus, which means the voltage at all the buses, the magnitude of voltage at all the buses are known to us. Okay, so based on these assumptions, and when I substitute this value into real and reactive power equations, so basically my equations reduce to this PP equation and QP equation. So you can see that sine of and cos of delta term comes, it just comes as a delta P minus of delta Q over here. Here sine term goes off. You basically had over here sine delta P minus of delta Q, which is equal to delta P minus of delta Q, but this remains as cos delta P minus of delta Q. So your equation is reduced to this, whether you write the VP term inside or outside. So okay, you can also write this VP term outside the summation sign. Fine. So now in this equation, this reduction in equation, how does it help me? Fine. So I know this VP values because all the buses are PV bus. So the voltage magnitude at all the buses are known to us. So this PP equation will help me to find out the deltas. Okay. And this particular set of, these are linear algebraic equations, which are for n minus one buses, because one bus you are going to consider as a slack bus. That's how the P is written, is 2 to n. Okay, I repeat, this is a linear set of algebraic equations, and there you will have totally n minus one equation because one of the bus we have considered as slack bus. So the delta values which we are getting it from here, we are going to substitute over this equation to get the QPs of the system. Fine. So now what happened is these two equations become decoupled. Fine. So this need not be solved simultaneously, but can be solved sequentially. Fine. And since the solution is non-iterative and it is the dimension is reduced to n minus one to from 2n, so it is computationally a highly economical solution. So this is all about your an approximate load flow solution. Fine. So I hope you have understood the concept till here. Now let us see what are the datas are required for load flow. Fine. So first I require the system data. I require the generator bus data, which are the buses having a generator. I require which of the buses are having a load data. System data basically talk about how many buses you have in your system, how many transmission lines you have in your system, how many generators you have. So I required kind of generator data. You know, generator data means what is the real power, what is the magnitude of voltage. Similarly, load data I required, what is the real power and reactive power data in that particular this one. And system data will also help you to know how many PV buses you have, how many PQ buses you have in your system, and which bus you have chosen as a slack bus. Then you require a transmission line data. Okay, so what are the series line admittances? What is the half line charging admittance values? And you require also a transformer data, which we have seen if the regulating transformer comes into picture, also the Y bus gets affected. And then you require the shunt element data. So all these datas are required to do a load flow analysis. Fine. So thank you guys for listening this particular lecture. I hope I have made your concept in calculation of line flows and line losses, slack bus power, constraints in the power system, and the data which need to be added, and what is an approximate load flow analysis. All these concepts I have made you clear, and have a nice day. Goodbye.